Hey, everybody, how y'all doing? Andrew Poncho Glover, Pro Player Promotion and Fire Photos Media Group. We're here on location in Birmingham, Alabama to bring you the GMen Nation Presents Dinner with the Pros. We're going to tell you what it takes to get to that next level and to maintain, baby. While we're here, we're going to go over to the Alabama Sports Hall of Fame and see if we can find us a three-sport athlete like the man for all season. We're going to see if he really exists. Is it live? Is it Memorex? Oh, lie. Tonight, we're going to have a good time. And we, like I said, we in Birmingham, Alabama. Me and my man, Fire Photo. Capion, Fire Photos. To you who don't know, you know what I'm saying? Media Group and Pro Player Promotion. Another big time production, baby. You know what it is? We're going up. It'll
be a good program tonight. Keynote speaker. We're going to address the crowd. Going to motivate some people. Pro Player Promotions on the set. Fire Photos, Media Group on the set. It's going down. Look out for us. I'm a classic man. You can be mean when you look this clean. I'm a classic man.
Glover competed in three sports, all while on football scholarship. Coach Eddie G. Robinson allowed Poncho to participate in all three sports as long as he kept his grades above average. Poncho achieved great success in all three sports and won championships with the basketball team, football team, and won the SWAC Triple Jump Trap Championship in 1989. This student athlete also made the honor roll during that time. Because of his athletic accomplishments, he was deemed the man of all seasons. Poncho was drafted in 1991 by the Los Angeles Raiders, spending 5 years in Los Angeles and one in Oakland. He also spent 3 years as tight end with the Minnesota Vikings organization. He eventually returned home to play for his favorite childhood team, the New Orleans Saints.
Who that?
No stranger to accolades. He was inducted to Grambling Legends Hall of Fame in 2020. He was also the Black College Sports inducted into the Black College Sports History of Legends. He was also the East Ascension Hall of Fame from his high school. Ladies and gentlemen, stand to your feet and welcome our MVP for tonight, the man of all season, Mr. Andrew Poncho Glover.
How y'all doing? I'm happy to be here tonight amongst such classy individuals and a football player that turned class for a night as well. Look, we are all happy to have the opportunity to give back to a man that gave to us, that gave so much to us, Coach Eddie G. Robinson. He instilled the will to work in your community, to come back, And after you have left and went off, wherever you've been, for me, all over the world, Japan, Mexico, Spain, playing football, you know, and being drafted by the Los Angeles Raiders in 91. We have several dignitaries here tonight. I'd like to thank everybody for taking the time to even come out and be a part of this celebration. This is the first annual G-Men Nation dinner. And we're very happy. I'm very happy to be here, to be a part of it, because it's all about, for us, impacting people's lives. Men, women, and children. That's the way we were taught. We were taught about community service. We were taught to give back by our coach. We were taught to act. We were taught how to dress, how to play football, more than just play football, and more importantly, how to graduate from college and go off in our respective areas of expertise and be the best at your job. Whether it was a football player, whether it was an officer of the law, whether it was a fireman, everybody in our organization is respected for being a G-man and for stepping on that field and giving it up for Coach Robinson. So we're very happy to be here. We have our Reverend Dr. Michael Jiles here with us as well, Herman, Arvie, the young block as I call him, and a lot of some of the people that have been working on this event, Miss Keye and Miss Newkirk as well. We certainly appreciate everything that you guys have done, all the tireless hours that you have spent to make this a beautiful occasion. We thank you for coming out. We're looking forward to sharing some of my stories about my time at Grambling and in the NFL, and getting to know each other and a little bit about my accomplishments along the way. So I certainly appreciate you. Thank you, and I will be right back with you.
First, bow our heads. Oh, gracious Father, Lord Jesus, how we come as humble as we know how. Father, thank you for your grace and mercy, Lord Jesus, that brought us through. And Father, first of all, we just thank you for allowing us to see a day that we never seen before. And Father, you know that you've been so good, Lord. You've been so kind. You've been so merciful. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we ask that you bless this occasion. Lord, we thank you for the G-Men Nation Incorporated, Lord Jesus. And we ask that you continue to lead and guide us in the way that you would have us to go. Father, we give you all the praises. We magnify you. We lift you up because, Lord, we know without you, none of this would have been possible. But Father, we ask that you look on everyone that's assembled on today. And Lord, continue to bless them. Bless their homes. Bless their families. Lord Jesus, bless them on their jobs. Bless them in their everyday endeavors, Lord Jesus. And Lord Jesus, we know that in anything we do, Lord Jesus, we know that we can look up to the hills with coming to our help. Because we know all our help will come from you. And Father God, as we prepare for our dinner, Lord, we ask that you bless those that prepared this dinner. Bless those, Lord Jesus, that cooked the dinner. And Lord Jesus, we ask that you continue to let it nourish and strengthen our body in the way you have it to be. And all God's children said, amen.
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 Good evening, everybody. Good evening. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Yeah. My name is Herman Arvie. I'm the executive director with G-Men Nation Incorporated. I want to thank you very much for coming out and spending some time with us as we try and conduct a wonderful fundraiser, have an opportunity to fellowship, engage with each other. You might be seeing some old friends you haven't seen in a while, so we thought it would be a great opportunity to put together this fundraiser, bring everybody together, and all for a great cause for dear old Grant. So, G-Men Nation, we formed in 2021, and it's pretty ironic because what brought us together was the pandemic. And I'm sure a lot of you have had situations where the pandemic has actually brought you together with family, friends, and the like. So we started on an app. One of our G-Men brothers introduced me to Marco Polo. Not sure. All right, you know, exactly. I had no idea about Marco Polo, and Dexter Butcher is his name. He reached out and sent me a text, and I actually had to check with him because I usually don't just click on links, so I had to make sure he sent it. And from there, we grew from the two of us conversing to right now we have 190 guys on the platform. So it's been a wonderful thing. And with that, we just decided, we said, hey, well, we haven't seen each other, some of us, in 30 plus years. Let's start doing some things. Let's get together. And that's where the idea of GMen Nation came from. And here we are today. So again, I welcome you. I thank you all for coming out. And let's have a great time. And make sure you guys bid on those auction items out there as well. Thank you. Recognize a few key individuals. The mayor's office is here tonight. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. So, would you like to come up and say a few words? Appreciate it.
Good evening, everybody. I am not the mayor, but I do have the honor and privilege of serving as his chief of staff. And my name is Cedric Sparks. So honored to be here with you today. I'm actually here in two capacities. I'm here as the emissary for our leader, for our mayor, Mayor Randall Lifton. And I'm also here as a parent. And I'm so thankful to be able to share with you all on his behalf for a couple of reasons. First of all, in my role as chief of staff, the vision that our mayor has for our city perfectly aligns with GMen's vision. I'm thankful that you all are committed to mentoring, that you're committed to nurturing and leveraging these relationships for the benefit of our youth and our community. That's what our mayor's belief is. We have a mission in our city of building community through servant leadership, because our belief is that we should not be kiss the ring in terms of how we move as government leaders, that we should be the chief servants for our community, and we should use our time, talent, and treasure for the benefit of our community. So I'm thankful that GMen has adopted the mindset of taking what's been poured into them and giving back to our community. The other reason I'm personally thankful is because I believe you can teach what you know, but you're going to reproduce what you are. And I'm thankful that as a father, I get the opportunity to walk in a legacy that many of you are walking in. We get the benefit as parents, my wife and I, to serve and to share with Principal-Darral Hudson and the leadership at A.H. Parker High School. We're parents there now. And one of your very own has the privilege of leading one of the athletic programs that our child is to be a part of. We are thankful of the legacy of GMen. We're thankful of the legacy of Grambling. And so on behalf of our mayor, on behalf of our families that are here, thank you all for coming to our city. Thank you all for building community through your servant leadership. And we look forward to enjoying this evening with you all. Thank you so much.
You're welcome to Good On Eat while we talk, while the show goes on. And one of the things that I wanted to make sure that I shared with this group, it's my first time doing it. I have a company out in Las Vegas, Nevada called Pro Player Promotions. We set up interactive experiences with ex-professional athletes and corporate clients. That's one of the things that I'm doing at the next level for ex-football players who don't feel worthy of getting the opportunity to get out and do anything or working for your family. Then we are bringing people together and building and encouraging them to get back out there, and that you do have a talent, and people are looking for people like you. And your talent, and you're an influencer as well. So with the way social media is going now and things that we did not have back when I was playing, I'm taking advantage of some of those things. Right now we have a lot of information in our vault. We have newspaper articles, pictures, video, community service, and testimonials. My cameraman and I from Five Photos Media Group have been together for 3 years now. And we have been, everywhere I go and everything I do, every school I go into, we are taping the interaction, how we're impacting the kids, how the questions that they're asking us, how we can better respond to them and be more prepared and be ready to speak with today's kid on their level. I don't
When I address people, I don't address everybody the same way, because some people are in a more mature way than an immature audience. And sometimes I would have to repeat myself several times to the kids to make them know and understand that your parents are your role model, the teacher is your role model, the principal is your role model. These are the people that's here every day working with you, trying to help you reach your maximum potential. Respect them every opportunity you get. You just can't look at me and say one day where the football player come in, everything he's got to say is true. Yeah, a lot of things that I have to say is true, but a lot of it is repeated from the way the kids are being brought up and what they're taught in the line of respect. So I have to make sure I mention to them that as well. This jersey right here, this is my Hall of Fame jacket. Right here, I just got it in 2020. One of my most prized possessions. I can't put a cost on it. I put in the work for it. I earned it. And I feel like I deserve it. And that's our mission, to let people know and to let kids know not to let anybody tell you what you're not capable of doing or cannot do. I am a multiple sport athlete, football, basketball, and track and field in high school and in college, and graduated in 4 years with a Bachelor of Science degree in criminal justice. I gave up every summer in order to stay at school and get extra hours. That's the price I paid to be a pro. I started acting like a pro, but I did not do it by myself. I had help. Before I go any further, I want to recognize where my help came from, and my strength come from the law. Because if you trust in the law, and you trust God, and you ask God, what is the vision for my life, and what can I do to be the best version of me so other people can see me, then the more you get on that track and the more you stay consistent with that, nothing is impossible. It will be revealed to you. I am the beneficiary of being and having the most fun ever doing a college experience, traveling all over the country with Grambling, playing football games, playing basketball games. Before I even got to the NFL, we was playing before 65,000 people. That transition wasn't that hard for me. I had to learn some other things, leaving from North Louisiana and going to California. Six-lane traffic and everybody going 90. They don't do it like that on the dirt road with that red dirt up and off. That, yeah, why? You gotta catch on, you better double dutch in. If you don't get right, you're going to be like Frogger. You're going to be trying to get across that street and wham, it happened to you. But I was prepared. I was ready. The atmosphere, Grambling, the academic atmosphere, my coach, and the people that helped nurture me, my wife, who I met at Grambling. I've been married for 29 years. I have 3 kids, and I've sustained a healthy marriage. If it wasn't for her, I would not be me. That's absolutely and positively the truth. If it was not for her, I would have merely not achieved the level of success that I have up until this point. I promise you. So God thank her for that. Those two people right there. Wow, and then comes me and the things that I had an opportunity to do and play and the places that I've been across around the world. And one of the more important things that I want to let everybody know is that we were a smaller college, but we've always had pride. We've always worked hard. We've always had a leader that believed in us, that believed that through competition and winning, we could influence change all over the world. And that's what he taught us. He taught us to be respectable and respected, respect our elders, and to dress nice. It was a prerequisite when we went out of town that you had to have a suit jacket and a tie. That's a must. And those early morning wake ups, when he wake us up at 6 o'clock, 6:30, every single day, so we would go to class, take our meal card and run to the cafeteria. And if you didn't go to the cafeteria, well, it was just up to him on how many days you were gonna not eat. That's on you. You did that. So I'm very fortunate to have been in his presence and have him teach me and inspire me in a way through athletics that I tried to jump up over the moon. So this is my Grambling here jersey that I have that I'm sporting old school. You can tell it's really old school because of the colors, maybe. Kind of look like a light bulb. But I'm proud of it. And every time I go to the Bayou Classic, I wear this jersey. It's a little tighter now than it used to be. Every time I go and I wear this jersey, I can be guaranteed one thing. Nobody else has one like it. So it's important to me. Whether it looks good to anybody else or doesn't look good or they think it's crappy, I think it's great and I'm proud of it. So I'm just letting you guys in on it tonight for a short period of time. Thank y'all. I don't know who's next on the list to be speaking. I may be over my time a little bit, but I'll be back.
Matthew 5 and 13 says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." Good evening. Tonight, we have gathered for this auspicious occasion for the sole purpose of exposing you to an organization that has made a conscious decision to be salt and light. With steel resolve, these men launched into the deep, and now they are on a powerful mission to preserve the communities they serve and to become a beacon light of hope to HBCUs. You see, a few salty brothers of various backgrounds and walks of life got together and decided to glean from the lessons they learned from a salty man by the name of Eddie G. Robinson, the late great coaching phenom. I imagine him peering over the balcony of heaven, nodding in approval as the seeds that he planted several years ago are growing through the men who sat at his feet. His lessons have become light to illuminate a path of grandeur. These brothers saw salt deficiencies amongst HBCUs and are now dedicated to doing something about it. We invite you to go to the website to read about the mission statement and the objectives, and you will know that they stand for something that is powerful. They are aligned with Matthew 5 and 13. Tonight, we are here because they want to give light to everyone in the house. They are here to let their light shine before others, to make their good deeds known and glorify God in the process. We are here because we want each of you to help us help them. Help us to help the next generation. Help us to inspire, motivate, serve, empower, provide scholarships, and level the HBCU playing field. And before I go, a man died and went to heaven. He was at the pearly gates by St. Peter, who led him down the golden streets. They walked by mansions after beautiful estates until they came to the end of the road, where they stopped in front of a little bitty shack. The man asked St. Peter, "Well, why did I get this little shack when there are so many mansions here?" And St. Peter replied, "I did the best I could with the money you sent us." This occasion is for each of you to help GMen Nation avoid dwelling in shacks, but to continue to build on the rich legacy and tradition of helping others so that the generations behind them will follow suit. Salt preserves, light illuminates. GMen Nation needs your help to do both. My name is Angela Newkirk, and I approve this message.
Only G-Man can do this.
And only one man can take credit for putting this small North Louisiana town on the national map. Eddie Robinson.
I love the game of football. I love the people who play the game of football more than I love football. And, you know, sometimes I tell my wife that I feel maybe my time may run out before I give back the football, what football is given to me.
Grambling, dear Grambling, we love thee dear, old Grambling.
Since 41, it's been Grambling, 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 and that's what it is. I wanted to coach since the time I was in fourth grade.
The first time that ball is snapped, you got to knock hell out of him and let him know one thing. That boy, you going to be in trouble this evening. You got a good man in front of you.
And when life's game is fought and won, the hills will ring the victory song.
It's the pride, the winning attitude that made us Grambling. It's the most rewarding profession in the world. And no man is too great to coach the American youth. Take that step and bring the children. All right, let's go down. Hit one. Turn. Good, good. Let me tell you about my whole career. I got a piece of every teacher I had, and every football player that's been through here, I got a piece of it.
I think I'm the luckiest man in the world to have the privilege to coach people like you.
Oh, Grambling, dear Grambling, we love you dear. Oh, Grambling.
Eddie Robinson, as far as black Americans are concerned, he is, if you will, the Vince Lombardi of coaches.
I hope you read the papers this morning. Did nobody pick you?
Eddie Robinson is about as admired as any coach that ever coached the game of football. He did things that these modern coaches with big staffs and all kinds of facilities never did.
It was almost like a marriage. Grambling needed him. They met just at the right time. And when they met, they both grew.
Eddie Robinson got the players who would have been going to LSU and Alabama and Georgia. Those guys went to play at Grambling because they couldn't play at those white schools.
Robinson sent more than 100 players to the NFL, beginning with Tank Younger to the Los Angeles Rams in 1949. Four others, Willie Davis, Charlie Joyner, Willie Brown, and Buck Buchanan, are enshrined in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. And in 1988, Redskins quarterback Doug Williams was named Super Bowl MVP, an honor unthinkable when Robinson began his own long walk to glory.
Let's not let the game get away and say what could have happened.
He could take you out of the backwoods of Louisiana, and pretty soon he had you living up to some expectations that you can have a career in this game.
But if professional football was not in a player's future, he was likely made of the right stuff for having played under Robinson. Some 80% of his players graduated.
He was someone who molded men, someone who was a pioneer, someone who was a teacher as much as a football coach.
Let's get him, man. Let's get him. Let's get him. Let's get him.
Eddie really took time to learn about the individual, to care for the person. And once you got to know him, you didn't want to disappoint Coach Rob because he was like a surrogate father to so many guys.
On October 5th, 1985, Robinson surpassed Bear Bryant's collegiate record with his 324th victory. After retiring from coaching in 1997 with 408 wins and 17 Southwestern Athletic Conference championships, Robinson remained closely entwined with the school he put on the college football map.
And he coached at Grambling from before Pearl Harbor all the way through to Bill Clinton's second term. 408 victories, only 8 losing seasons in 55 years. And in his second season, Robinson's Grambling team was not just undefeated, they did not allow a single point out.
My father, well, as I have said many times before, just the thought of someone having an idea to consider building or renovating a structure of any kind in the name of a family member to us is just unbelievable. My father always liked the saying that dreamers are the saviors of the world. Well, this is certainly a dream come true for the Robinson family.
Coach Robinson taught us, open the door for a lady. Yes, sir. No, sir. How to sit at the proper table and use the proper fork and the spoon. Now, I know this because I was at his house and ate there many times.
Yeah, well, he would think it would be great, you know, get to see his guys walking around tuxedo, you know, coming from Mississippi and some of the poor area of Louisiana and in Mississippi. You know, he'd look at you and say, boy, you're not the 17-year-old kid I saw way back when. And he would be proud. He'd be proud to know that his players turned out great.
I want the guys who play for us to play in the NFL. But now, if I were in the sciences, I'd be out there trying to get somebody to help put the man in space. This is what it is. Whatever field you're in, you got to work.
In the early days, Eddie Robinson also taught phys ed and coached men's and women's basketball. By the time future NBA Hall of Famer Willis Reed came to the campus from Jonesboro, Coach Rob was coaching strictly football.
Matter of fact, he tried to recruit me to come to Grambling to play football. But I had a chance to see Jules Buchanan and Ernie Ladd with basketball shorts on the basketball team. And these guys were so big and muscular, and I was like a 225 skinny 6'9 kid out of high school. I said, I'm not playing football at Grambling.
First of over 200 Grambling players that would eventually play professional football. Robinson coached 4 NFL Hall of Famers, including Willie Davis of the Green Bay Packers, Buck Buchanan of the Kansas City Chiefs, Charlie Joyner of the San Diego Chargers, and Willie Brown of the Oakland Raiders.
It instilled a lot of things in me and a lot of the players who came to Grambling is to follow in his footsteps and you'll be all right.
Grambling's Will Brown is considered one of the best defensive backs to ever play the game. A Super Bowl champion with the Oakland Raiders in 1977, Willie was named to the Hall of Fame in 1984.
He was one of the main reasons why I am in the Hall of Fame, because of his leadership and his toughness and work harder than everybody else and those kind of things paid off for me. Oh yeah, no question about it. He was there. He and Al Davis have a great relationship. Al Davis being the owner of the Oakland Raiders, and he wanted to make sure, and I wanted to make sure that Coach Robinson was there. So he had a good time. And it was a fun time for me, fun time for him, because he was proud of the things that happened. And being a part of me, you know, growing up and with his leadership and his guidance, another one of his football players made it in the Hall of Fame.
And now, nearly 3 years after Coach Rob's passing, the story and legacy is preserved and protected at the Eddie G. Robinson Museum, located on the campus of Grambling State University. Longtime friend and colleague Wilbert Ellis promised Coach Rob that one day there would be a museum. Wilbert promised that just days before Eddie died.
I said, Coach, we're going to build that museum. We're going to get that museum. He said, oh, boy, you ain't going to do that. And just the other day, he got word that it's done. I know he did.
You promised him, didn't you?
I promised him.
No matter whether he won the game or he lost the game, he has to move on to the next game. He doesn't even have time to think about that game, not even the one he won. And he doesn't have time to think about the one he lost. He's going on.
408 wins, 165 losses, 15 ties, 57 consecutive seasons, earning the NCAA benchmark for wins in Division I college football. More than 200 men to enter the National Football League, with a few of those men reaching the grand stage of the Super Bowl. Countless numbers of athletes, students, staff, and administration transformed.
I think Coach Robinson probably impacted my life more than anybody else besides the people in my family.
He had a great impact on me because I always wanted to be like a guy like Eddie Robinson. I always wanted to coach. Coaching was on my mind ever since I was 9 years old. So he just made an impact. He was somebody very special in my life, and I wanted to be like him.
He impacted my life from an impact of motivation, motivating you to be the best that you can be.
Coach Eddie Robinson was the greatest motivator. He was inspirational. He affected players on his team to overachieve, but yet on the other hand, he was really concerned about each of his students getting a college degree. For that, he's responsible for over 200 NFL players and thousands of teachers and principals who are going on to make a difference in lives of so many here in the great state of Louisiana.
I guess I'm most proud of those who graduated and those who went on to make a contribution to our society. And when I speak of contribution, that you can live in society and be a part of it and be good Americans.
Dallas, Texas, October of 1985, when he broke Bear Bryant's record. With that eclipsing Bear Bryant's record in Dallas in 1985, he then became the winningest college football coach in the country. So there are a vast number of memories, fond memories of his successes, but if I would pick one out, it would be when he broke Bear Bryant's record.
I can remember getting the stories of him getting tanked down to the train station down there and telling me he was going to do more for the NFL, for African Americans, than he would ever think of. And we know the rest of the story when he got out there to the Ram. Tank Young is what I'm speaking of. And he opened the doors and to go on and send, during that time, we used to send as many guys to the pros as Notre Dame was doing, But that was the man's motivation. He didn't care about you telling these sob stories of how you was oppressed.
If we have to pass it to win, we're gonna pass it. If we have to play defense to win it, let's play defense. If it's gonna take offense to go all the way to win it, let's do that. But remember, we got to carry back the Grambling. Remember who you are, your tradition, your legacy, and let's go play. Come on.
He's very happy up there. I know he said, well, they got it done.
Of being coached by the very best in his craft and being well respected by every coach in America. So these guys are going to come up and give you some insight. But anyway, in reference to being greedy again, I almost forgot. Ooh, a lot of hits in the NFL, but I got it. I'm going to get it. Oh, I'm going to catch up to it, one or two. About the state dinner. You know, the day of the game, we used to congregate and get ready to eat the steak before the game. And so, so a couple of those guys, bigger guys, and sometimes that little sirloin strip, and you cut it right, you can get so many pieces on it, but it ain't that gigantic piece of meat for a big football player, what I'm about to go out here and do. I'm going to get beat up for this thing, so I might as well eat a big one. But at any rate, we would all be, in there and, eating the steaks. And he'd be watching, he'd be looking around the table, and we'd be looking around the table because somebody, you know, the waiters would be coming and they'll be bringing steaks fast as you can take them. One guy, he'll hurry up, knock his off and grab, get ready to grab another. He goes, hell no, one steak for a man. You can't get no more than anybody else got. And he would not let you get it. It was well known around the camp, do not get caught trying to get you an extra steak, or you might have to run some stadium. So, you know, everybody get there, everybody do their part, and we'll celebrate after. We might give you two after the game, but you cannot have two before the game. At any rate, these men of distinction are here tonight to give you an insight about the great coach, Eddie Robinson, and we're going to get started with the Reverend Doctor, one of my teammates, Michael Jiles.
In all praises, the one that sits high and looks low, and the one that God lead us every day. And without him, I don't know where you would be, I don't know where I would be. Because it's his strength every day that carries us through. First of all, thank you, City of Birmingham, for having us. But my G family knows that this is Grambling, man.
All right.
We have dominated the city of Birmingham as we have won several. I didn't say one. Just say two.
Yeah.
But several SWAT championships over at Legion Field.
That's right.
So we basically own the city. Oh, Birmingham.
All right.
All right. There were many, many distinguished guys that came from this great city and state that set the tone for Grambling State football. For some of you all Alabamians that don't know Junious Buchanan from Alabama, Birmingham set the tone. Hall of Fame, NFL Hall of Fame, first round draft pick, set the tone for Grambling State University football. We go on down the list. You look at guys like Frank Warren, your head coach.
Yay.
Parker High School. Also, we look at one of your former head coaches, Andre Robinson. Parker High School served as athletic director and head football coach. Also served as an assistant football coach for Grambling State University as well as an All-American. We go down the list and look at guys like Kenny Petway, Albert Reese from Viger High School, Thomas Griffin from Viger High School. You had all of those distinguished guys from Alabama, Jeremy Gordon from Alabama as well, that played in the black and gold for Coach Eddie Robinson. But being a part of these distinguished gentlemen, those that you all have met tonight, some that you don't know, was one of the greatest experiences in my life. We have established friendships forever. Most guys that play college ball, once the 40 years are up, they don't even see each other no more. But we have come together 30 years later like we were still knowing each other as we were in school. And that's a great accomplishment because it starts with your leader. Coach Andrew Robinson led by example. And he taught us how to be great men, great husbands, great fathers, and he taught us how to continue to live the legacy that he taught us to do. We always put God first, because without him, we wouldn't be nothing. Go to church, get your education, do what he wants us to do. When he signed you, he told the parents, two things your son's going to do. He's going to go to church, he's going to graduate. Those two things we did do. I'm being asked to kind of shut it down, I think, because of the dinner that's coming. But I'm going to continue. Because there are some more things that needs to be said about our great institution, Grambling State University. So we're going to pause right now. So you may continue your dinner, but we will be back for a second edition. God bless you. I'm a Baptist preacher as well, so I can talk.
GMen Nation, our mission is to support not only Grambling, but all HBCUs. You know, we've historically haven't had the resources, and part of our mission is to get out here, do things such as this, and do tremendous fundraising so that we can give back to the HBCUs and to the programs so that they can compete on a level and not say what we didn't have. Because when I played, which was 89 through 92, and the guys, when they played, we didn't have anything. But it's like a kid, when you're poor, you don't know you're poor. So now we know. So we can do better. So I want to bring this gentleman up. He didn't play at Grambling, but he played against Grambling. He was a teammate of mine. We actually went to Cleveland together in 1993. And he is HBCU FAMU, Mr. Wally Williams, and he also was a teammate of Poncho's in New Orleans.
King Rattler.
Yes, sir.
King Rattler's out there.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes,
amen. Thank you, Grambling faithful and supporters, for allowing me to hang out with you guys for an evening. I'll bring a different perspective. Grambling from the opposing side. Now, as Herman stated, you know, we came in together as rookies in 93. And he was there from 89 to 92. And we played Grambling three times during that time period. And we got smacked around pretty much all three of them. And I think the last one that we played in the Heritage Bowl, we kind of gave up. We just did not want to get beat. I'm going to tell you the truth. This is some real stuff. And Herman noticed. That was the fattest group of offensive linemen I've ever seen. Okay, and, you know, we didn't have nobody on our team nowhere near their size across the board. Matter of fact,
hey, we wore it well. Hey, don't say it like that.
Gant was as big as a running back as a D lineman as we have on our team. So by the time, you know, the game got in the second quarter, and you having Gant running through there beating you to death, and you got Dexter Butcher,
sure.
Okay, running the speed to the outside, and those are some dangerous combinations for any team to deal with, and especially us. We came in the Grambling a couple of times. We came down to the pit one time, and in that bowl that y'all call a field. Okay. The grass wasn't even green. It was like brown.
That's when we had hay on the side.
Yeah, I don't know what the perspective outside of FAMU is, but I think it was kind of bougie at times. We had stuff kind of laid out, and we had never seen anything quite like that. And not only was it brown, it wasn't stable. It was really like playing on hay. It was a total home field advantage, and we got smacked around there too. Okay. But I think the thing, you know, for us really as a community and you know, as a university, and definitely for me personally, and Coach Riley, Ken Riley, who played number six in the NFL, was our head coach at that particular time. Now, there's a tremendous amount of respect that, you know, we had for Coach Robinson and what he was able to do here. You talk about a guy, even in our circles, was a bigger-than-life figure. And, you know, we had Jay Gaither over there at Florida A&M, but I don't think his presence really had a profound feeling as much as you know, Coach Robinson did when he made a trip to Tallahassee. And
rarely do, and I can say this because, you know, when he's not here, but I'll say this just from looking at it. You know, I really do not inherit this bowl game because that game was lost before it started. And I'm talking about like the Wednesday before it started.
Yeah,
okay. The middle of the week.
Right.
You're not waiting until Friday to lose a game. I knew it was lost way before we started. And the way that Coach Riley, okay, revered Eddie Robinson when he came into Tallahassee, okay, really, and Herman can co-sign this, it took over the city, okay, took over the city, and had their way with the city itself and everything going on over there, and they came over there and beat us in the Heritage Bowl. That may have been the inaugural.
That was the second one.
Second Heritage Bowl.
45-15.
Thank you for reminding me of that. But it was one of those deals, and then I get to hear Herman rattle this off for the next 3-4 years, and we were teammates, reminding me that you guys never came to Grambling and got anything done, all right, against that black and gold, all right? It was a problem, and it was a problem. But, you know, I always cherish the relationship that I have with other guys in Hampton Black colleges, and like I said, I was also a teammate of Glover's too in New Orleans when I played for the Saints. And, you know, I'll say this about, you know, pro sports and just the personal feeling when you see somebody that came from HBCU that was able to make it and play as long as we were able to play. Look, there's a different path that we have to take. You guys see it. I think you see a lot of things that Prime is doing up there in that other school up there. We got to deal with those guys too. But I think that what he's able to do is expose some things within our football culture that hopefully will be addressed. Not only be addressed from just a national standpoint, but, you know, be addressed from an alumni standpoint. And we have our problems over there at Florida and with alumni and raising money and all those things like that, which is why we also have a chapter, much like we have here, we have the FAMU football chapter. And our program is dedicated strictly for earmarking monies for our athletes, for our young athletes. Look, we are not dealing with the university. I'm sorry. Okay. We can't go to the university to get anything done with our program right now. We want to raise money with our group of guys, same mindset. We come together, we bring our athletic dollars to the table and present that to the young men who are out there dedicating themselves and trying to be the best possible athletes they can be. So we share the same thought process. We share a lot of our conversations and our visions. And look, I'm just waiting for you guys to come over to Tallahassee so we can show the same kind of hospitality to you guys with our alumni chapter. And we're trying to make this, like you said, we want to make this thing a networking operation for every school to bring our dollars here to give our kids a better chance, because trust me when I tell you this, we are nowhere near what the Division I programs do. So when I see an Andrew Glover, okay, coming to the NFL, I see a Herman Arvie coming to the NFL, I know they have done the work. And I know they had to go through whatever trials and tribulations that nobody of these Division I schools even think about. Okay? They don't have to worry about wearing the same piece the entire football season.
What?
Okay, they get 30 boxes of shoes a week per player. Okay? They ain't gotta worry about, you know, actually washing your jock strap and then having it ready for practice the next day. Okay? I didn't know how to act when I got to the grounds and I walk in the back and I say, hey man, can I get some socks? You look like I was a clown, man. Go ahead and get what you want. I'm like, huh? You mean to tell me I'm going in that room back there to get any piece of equipment I want to have? Where have you been? I've been at an HBCU. I don't know what y'all do up here, but no, this is not how we do things. So, look, when we got up there, an opportunity that presented us up there, we're going to get up here and do the best job we can. That's why we have so many guys. You guys have so many guys historically in the Hall of Fame and have been treasures at the next level. is because you got it right here. It doesn't get really any harder than how we did it right here. I would say some of the other NFL was a cakewalk.
You know, hour and a half practice.
Come on now. Hour and a half practice. We didn't leave there until it was done. And that can be whenever. So, look, the experiences that we share, all of us collectively share, and definitely what we're trying to project now in the community by bringing things together, I think we've always shared those things. And then starting here now, look, Love, Herman, we've been doing this for quite some time. Quite some time. So I am excited about the future of both you guys coming to Tallahassee and roll up on those 7 buildings. Okay? So thank you for having me. Thank you for having me. Thank you.
Right. Thanks, Wally. And I also want to recognize the gentleman sitting over to my right, Mr. Sean Smith, another one of our G-Men brothers who played for the Bears. And so, thanks for coming out, bro. Last but not least, we have my brother, Keifer Block Phillips. Come up and speak. My old room now.
Thank you, thank you. I think I'm gonna use the podium if that's okay with everybody. I'm glad y'all still eating so you don't have to look up and make me start sweating more than I might be. Anyway, so the three guys that went before me and everybody that spoke tonight are offensive players that played offense. So they like being on the field long. I'm a defensive player, so I will not be long. Then I'm going to try to stick to task. So I want to speak to my reflection at Grambling when I was there. So I made notes, some of these was like, tell a script. I do this by trade, so I'm sorry. I'm so regimented. But my experience at Grambling, for me, I call it a destiny realized. I took a detour from high school right before I went to Grambling. And the reason I say that is because Coach Rob and I have some ties that kind of go in the background. 3 times removed. He's from Baton Rouge, from Jackson, Louisiana, small town in Louisiana. And we both went to McKinley High School. And my mother lived, before she moved, we lived 2 houses from Eddie Robinson Senior Drive in Baton Rouge. So we got a lot of connections. And one of my biggest experiences or reflections are Coach cemented it one day at practice. I was on the scout team when I transferred to Grambling. So I was there to pay my dues. And one of the things I learned earlier was service. So how does service help? How does everything on the team make a team go? So being on the scout team and giving the first team and the guys that start a great look and a great work in practice every day made them a better team, made them better players at what they did. And I think Mr. Wiley just spoke to the result of that, because that was my first year, and that was the year they went and beat the Rattlers in the Heritage Bowl 45-14. And I was there, and what he did mention was that 15-play drive to start that really made the game over with, so it was downhill after that. But one of my highlights were made a great play in practice on one big hit. So, you know, on defense, we like to call him the ooh. Made a big ooh hit in practice. And again, I'm younger than all these guys in here, and they were stalwarts. They were statues. They were giants when I went up to visit the school. So Coach Rob told the guy after we made the hit, he said, "Hey, man, you better go full speed. My homeboy don't take no wooden nickels." So the fact that he told him that was the fact that he said homeboy. Once he said homeboy, he recognized me that, again, we're from South Baton Rouge. I live 2 streets from his street named after him. And we both are alumni at McKinley Senior High School in Baton Rouge. So that was a great experience for me. Moving forward, outside of practice, one of my fondest memories of Grambling was the lessons learned from Coach Rob and my experience at Grambling. Coach Rob left a lasting impression, as well as GSU and some of those things I still use in life today. Back as Mike said, with Coach Rob, you knew one thing, faith was strong with him. He was God first. He made sure we knew he was God first, and when you hear him speak,
or see any of his players, you know that he was a God first person. Family. Hey, man, you need to treat your girlfriend right if you got one. Be a gentleman. Always be polite. I have life. Firm handshake. Look a man in his eye when you're talking to him. Hold your head up.
That's right.
And work. So in work, life today, so 10 years removed from school, 10 years removed from playing football, all the captains that was the captain of the team would occasionally have to speak after practice. And when we stand up and speak after practice, or when we have a great that will come back, we all know, take a knee in the end zone under the goalpost. And when it was time for that captain to go up to speak, Coach Rob would take a knee. So here this is, a giant amongst giants, leading all these men, but he showed that respect that he would go and be in the audience as well. And one of the things that you would learn if after hearing everybody speak today is, if he didn't hear you, what would you hear? Bring it from the gut. And that meant, I didn't know what that meant, but it resonated because when I was at the other school before I got to Grambling, I had my first 5-minute speech in public speaking class. And I said, well, I can do 5 minutes. That ain't going to be nothing out of high school. And I think I was 30 seconds in, shirt soaking wet. My stomach was all over the place. So that's what he means. You speak from the gut. It knocks that rolling out of your voice. And you can speak and you can get it out. So as I'm at work and as I speak in front of people at work, it's always a, okay, you got one of these old Coach Rob stories. And it was that my first couple years when I make the first few speeches. Then afterwards, once they saw some of the lessons that they learned from me speaking those speeches and saying those things, they see how it still resonates in life and how it treats you in life. Oh, okay, they be ready to hear a good old story every now and then. So I break up the news. And lastly, the thing I think was great most from Grambling, Coach humbleness. His humbleness, we talked about this at the G-Man Nation in one of our Zoom calls and at homecoming. Coach Rob was so humble, and we were so regimented at Grambling to be Grambling, to be a stand-up, to be an example, and to be a leader, that we never bragged. We never was braggadocious, and we always hated that about the Bayou Classic. We go play the Bayou Classic, of course, it's in New Orleans, in the Super Bowl, I mean, it's in a pro stadium. But by the time we make it to the Classic, we done played in 5 pro stadiums. We done played in front of 80,000 people before we got down there, so it was second nature. Only thing I hate was when Southern would score that bandit crank up, and they get all flashy and all that. And that wasn't our thing. So when we beat them, we just beat them. When we walk out, we didn't have to brag. But the humbleness, I think, was a great trait that we got from him. And lastly, and I see E3's here, I love your grandfather's approach to teaching the whole man, coaching the whole man. When you left Grambling, you didn't leave Grambling as a football player. You went in there as a young boy, a young teenager. You definitely wasn't a young man. But when you left, you was a young man. You knew how to guard first. You know how to respect people. You know how to treat everybody. From, if you go to somewhere, you look for the manager. You look for the owner. No, you look for the person that's cutting the grass, the person that's dumping the trash. Because he's the one that make you go. You respect everybody you see and that you meet. And you serve. You be in life to serve. So that lesson today still helps and still resonates. And the seed that he planted, 92, 94, so however many years you want to do the math, that seed is still bearing fruit today. As you see all the G-Man that's been speaking today, you see all the G-Man and G-Women that put this together. As we talked, this fundraising event. Chuck got the fundraising part. I always tell him I'll do my part on what I'm the treasurer for the G-Man Nation. And I'll do all of that part, but Ms. Keye, I know she's not in here, but everything that everybody does that leads from Grambling, where everybody is somebody, if nothing else is truer to the statement, that's a true statement. So what I learned from that is, what you see today is evidence. So we don't have to really do as much, but that's my experience from Grambling, and thank you very much. With that being said, I have another spoke about me and Coach Rob having some things that's going back, right? So I'm going to now have the privilege to announce the first annual G-Man Nation Junior's Buck Buchanan Award winner. And you're going to see there's going to be some simulations between the honoree name and the recipient as I go further on. And again, I'm going to read
to make sure I stay on pace. So even though I said this, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Keifer Phillips, and again, I have the pleasure tonight to present the G-Man Nation's first annual Junious, hope I said his name right, because it's not the L, but Buchanan Award. But before I give background on this award, I'd like to thank the Buchanan family for allowing us the permission to use his name to honor this award tonight, and I'd like to give them a big hand clap, please. All right, so Buck Buchanan was a man in stature, accomplishments, and of course in the game of football and in life. Some background on Buck Buchanan. He was born in the state of Alabama. He played for, I'm going to go in reverse order, so he played college for the NFL. He played for the AFL, Kansas City Chiefs, and the NFL Kansas City Chiefs. He won championships in both the AFL championship and he won a world championship. In college, well, I'm going to give you all his accolades. He's a six-time AFL All-Star, two-time Pro Bowl selection. He's an AFL champion and a world champion. He is Pro Football Hall of Fame, of course, and he's College Hall of Fame. So, Buck Buchanan, in 1963, the 6'7", 287-pound Buchanan. One little quick story. When I went on a recruiting trip to Grambling, and I got out of the car with my homeboy, he was my recruiting, what we call them, escorts? Yeah, when we recruited our high school guy, the escort. So he took me to, we went to the party. And we went to the party, and he picked me up from the hotel, and he took me to the dorm. So when I get to Holland Hall, we go upstairs, no elevator. So we walk up the steps, and the first two guys I ever saw at Grambling was Andrew Glover and Frank Thomas. Now, the reason I say this is because they had T-shirts on. So my homeboy, Dale Mirabar, played defensive end for Grambling. So I kind of look at him like, maybe right here. So I look at these two guys when I get into the stop of the stairs coming out the hallway walking. I say, golly, man, I'm going to have some nice defensive ends when I get here. And he said, no, they tight ends. I said, what? Yeah, so he was splitting. He was a receiver. I said, so I'm going to have to be checking them? So I stopped them. I said, well, where the linemen at? And, you know, of course, they was 10 times towering over him. I was like, Jesus Christ, that's a giant. So long story short, Buck was 6'7", 287 pounds. He was the first player selected in the AFL draft by the Kansas City Chiefs. The first player, he was a first, we always have a lot of firsts at Grambling. First black player from HBCU, I don't think they called it HBCUs back then. Coach Rob endeared a statement, and I'm quoting, he said that this was the finest lineman I have ever seen when he quoted talking about Buck Buchanan. So I'll get into his high school because we know that now he played for the Kansas City Chiefs. He went to Grambling. He's a G-man. And his high school was A.H. Parker High School. Anybody know that school? All right, so in FCS, football, the former 1AA, it's a championship series. They call it a football championship series now. So in this series, they had an offensive player award that was named for the best offensive player, which was the Walter Payton Award. So in 95, they created the Junious Buck Buchanan Award to honor the defensive player in the conference. And this award went from 95 to 2012, and it was awarded to the most outstanding defensive player. Remember that point. So, more to come later, and I just said that part about that. So, we will be honoring, G-Man Nation will be honoring individuals, not that play football or play football, whatever they may have done great in life or whether they're doing great in life, promoting and putting back into young people, putting back into the community. That's what we're going to be honoring for the recipients that will be getting this award as we move forward in our events and as our group grows. So, with that being said, well, let me say it like I wrote it.
without further ado, I had to give me a fancy word, I had to get my wife to help me with that. I would like to present the first annual G-Man Nation, Inc. Junious Buchanan Award to a former A.H. Parker High School graduate, a former G-Man, and a record holder, the Russian champion. Wasn't going to say it because I didn't want to give certain things away. Great husband and a father of three. And I wrote that off for looking at Facebook. And this is quoted. For his unmatched contribution to the community and student athletes, we honor his outstanding leadership, fearless courage, humility, and commitment to empower, educate, and ignite young men to reach their full academic and athletic potential. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to present our very first Junious Buchanan Award winner to Frank Warren.
Yeah, step in front of the chairs.
Get this out of the way. I'm not Frank. I am his brother. he knew that. I'm Cornelius. Well, Frank is actually in Kentucky right now with one of his players on a recruiting trip. So I'm here standing in his stead. I kind of feel like I'm not up to par with some of these greats in this room. But Frank, going to Grambling introduced us to something special. I'll say that. I was in Publix in Homewood, which is not far from here, a couple of years ago, and I happened to have a Grambling football shirt on. And somebody hollered behind me, "Gram fam." I said, that's not me. I said, "That's my brother. I know what you're thinking about." I said, "Well, that's my brother." I can't remember who said it, but somebody came up here and said that once you develop a relationship with the players, teammates at Grambling, it's a long-lasting relationship. My brother got married, I think about 8 years ago, isn't that right? 10 years ago, I'm missing 2 years. He got married 10 years ago, and he had all his brothers up here as a groomsman, his blood brothers and his Grambling brothers. And that meant a lot to me. We went out the night before. We called it a prayer meeting. We had a lot of fun the night before, just preparing for a commitment. We'll move on from that. But I will say, you know, Frank spent a little time in the NFL. We would have liked for him to spend a little bit more time in the NFL. But it was the right timing for him, because had he not transition from that point, he would not be where he is today, leading those young men at A.H. Parker High School. I'm an attorney, so I'm kind of long-winded, so I'm going to end it right here. We appreciate y'all for this award, and I think we were going to try a video conference, Frank.
He actually is on Zoom.
He's on Zoom.
He's listening now.
Oh, he's listening. Frank, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear you.
And he's soft-spoken. He is very soft-spoken. He's the baby of the family. He's number seven. He represents the number of completion. He completed my mom and dad family.
Let's see if we can get Frank to say
something. I think I heard him try and say something.
There you go.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Go right ahead.
To accept the award. I know my brother, my family, I'm sorry I'm not to be there, but God said I'm another mission for one of my players. And I'm honored to be a part of this. And I want to thank everybody who showed up. It's an honor. I'm sorry I can't be there. I wish it was another day, but I want to thank y'all.
All right.
Thank you once again.
How we doing? We still hanging in there?
Yeah.
The night is young, right? All right, so I am bringing you, I want to speak with you about GMen Nation and our forward thought process where we are trying to take GMen Nation. And so, as I said, we established in 2021, and I touched on the mission a little bit, but I wanted to give a little insight in terms of the makeup of the organization. As I said, it's, you know, former players, but not just former players. In order to put together something like this, you have to have a team. So we have a team of players, but also non-players, supporters of the organization who have the same vision and to allow us and help us reach our goals. So if you are not currently a member, we have active memberships, we have associate memberships, we would love for you to join the team. And it's real simple. You can just go to our website, which is www.gmennation.com, .org. And go to the contact page, and there you'll see we have a membership form. We're actually revamping the website, so it's going to be a little bit more user-friendly. The webmaster is not the greatest when it comes to, you know, doing that. So we have a support team now in place to help with that. So you'll see a new look and feel to the website here coming pretty soon. So go to the contact page, sign up to become a member. If you want to contribute, you can make donation right on the website. And you can also make your, what we call donations, but, you know, membership dues, you can pay those directly on the website as well. Well, soon to come. We're going to be flipping the switch on that here pretty soon. So, some things that we have done over the course of a year, we've, along with Dinner with the Pros, which this is our first one, and we plan on doing these every year. We also have a summit, a GMen Nation Summit. We had our second annual GMen Nation Summit. We held it over the spring game. So for those who were there, y'all saw a beautiful sight. We had a goal. It was 500 GMen Strong campaign to bring back 500 GMen to be on campus for the spring weekend, all at the same time. And I believe we hit our goal. We didn't have an official count, but there were a lot of brothers out there. So that was a wonderful, wonderful thing. And if you were there, you were witness to it. So along with that, we had a coat and clothing drive in Shreveport in December. That was a tremendous opportunity to give back to the community, and we're going to take this and we're going to hit different cities. So look for GMen Nation to be in a city near you in the near future, but we're going to continue to do that and again support our communities and give back. In January there was a fundraiser for Coach Hugh Jackson in Atlanta. That was an awesome opportunity to again help raise funds to support the program. So it was a great turnout. If anybody, I know I see a few familiar faces, really appreciate everybody's support coming out, and we're going to continue to do these things. So look for us in a city near you. What else? So we also have, and I got to give kudos to my brother, my big brother, Sean Smith. He has spearheaded, and actually he's been like I said, he's my big brother. He's been doing this over the course of years. And I'm happy to have his support and be able to step out front a little bit. You know, I'm usually a guy in the background, but, you know, I appreciate you allowing me to step out front and lead the charge, so to speak. But we have a season ticket campaign. And what we do, you know, not everybody is living in the area to attend home games at Grambling, but we want you to still support and purchase your season tickets. And what we've done is we partner with a local nonprofit, and we actually offer the tickets to deserving students at local high schools. So if you're not planning on utilizing your season tickets, please purchase them anyway. Donate them to GMen Nation, you know, and we'll donate them on your behalf to the deserving students. So now, what else we got going? So this one here with COVID is kind of stunted our growth the last couple of years, but we're going to have a GMen Nation cook-off contest. And I tell you, Marco Polo, if y'all saw our content, man, actually, we're going to have a reality TV show. I'm really going to do it. Because we got some hilarious stuff, man. We got our chefs. We got Chef Poncho.
Representing the G-Man Nation Culinary Institute.
Yes, sir.
Down South style. We do it all. Gumbos, barbecues, balls. You want it, we can make it happen. G-Man Nation Culinary Institute.
That's right. We got Chef Dr. Rev, MJ, Michael Giles. Yes, sir. We have Block. I think I see you throwing out a few jobs. I think Block might be in it also. Yes, sir. But we have plenty of guys, so we're gonna do again another opportunity for a fundraiser. Say it again. Oh, and B-Way. I think B-Way's on Zoom. Broadway, Gerald Broadway, the Bistro. So we're looking forward to doing that. I think we're gonna do it for homecoming, coordinate, and have some other events like Dunk a G-Man. Have a dunking contest, so you know, get an opportunity to dunk a few guys, including me. And we are also going to be planning a G-Men Nation cruise. All right? A G-Men Nation cruise. So look for this awesome information coming down the pike here pretty soon. Love to have your support. We appreciate you coming. And again, all the information is going to be uploaded. The content is going to be on the website. That's www.gmendation.org. All right. So next up, Miss Ingruil. Miss Keye.
Good evening. Thank you all for coming out to our first annual Dinner with the Pros. I appreciate all of you being here. And so you guys, we're just so delighted that you guys accepted our invitation and you gave contribution to our organization. So we want to thank you in advance. First, give an honor to God, because I know that there's a lady in this room that would be very upset with me if I did not give honor to God. But most importantly, not only would she be upset, but there's this phobia, this fear that I have with deer foam house shoes. They're pink deer foam house shoes. So to this day, I would not wear them. So when I was growing up as a kid in Jonesboro, Hodge, Louisiana, I used to get beat down in the Piggly Wiggly with a pink deer foam house shoe. So I just want to make sure that that does not happen. So I want to provide you all with the results of the silent auction. And so far we have the G helmet, the Grambling State University helmet, that has been now that of Mr. Lonnie B. Smith. He bid it $250. So, and there are still items over there for bidding, so please go over to the reception area and place your bid. Thank you.
Ms. Keye?
Yes.
Hold on 1 second. Don't move. So, everyone, Ms. Keye, as we affectionately call her, that's what she goes by, has been a rock star with coordinating and putting together this awesome event. So, we really appreciate you. And as a token of our appreciation, I want to present you with...
Come in the front. Come to the front of the chairs. Step in the front. Step in the front with it.
This is beautiful.
Yeah, take a picture. Both of you together.
Expecting anything. Honestly, I'm kind of a behind the scenes type of person. I really don't like to be front and center. Mainly when I'm speaking before my doctors, my pediatricologist, that's where I feel most comfortable because I'm constantly teaching them and educating them on growth hormone deficiency. But to receive something that I really love and I enjoy doing, this is awesome. This is really awesome. So thank you so very much.
A couple of pictures.
Oh, sure.
Step in front of the chair, please. Right there. Thank you. And just hold for one more. 3, 2. What's that? Oh, All right.
All right, congratulations again, one more time. Miss Keye, one more time. Boy, I miss y'all. While I was sitting over there waiting, man, the program couldn't get along, man. I thought I was supposed to do be the whole part of the whole thing. I thought it was about me. It's about everybody. Everybody's involved. So, hey, look, we certainly appreciate you guys coming out and spending time with us. We appreciate you bringing the youngsters out because that's who we want to help impact their lives, help tell them some of the insider trade secrets that made us able to ascend to the top of our game and to be able to stay there. It's one thing to get there, and everybody wants to get there. And I was telling the gentleman earlier, one of the analogies that I use is a lot of people want it. Everybody in this room want it. I want it. If I say, well, who all want to be successful? Who all want to have nice things? Want to have nice things? Say, I want it. But Eddie Robinson would say, are you willing to pay the price to get it? The difference between you and me is that you want it, but I got to have it. That's a different mindset. You want it, but I got to have it. And I am just, I'm happy to be celebrating myself about at least 25, 30 years in the community and in community service. You can follow me on Instagram. We're getting ready to work with Five Photos Media Group and Pro Player Promotions. We're going to be working in the near future on docuseries about our experiences at HBCU and HBCU unheralded heroes that you won't see on ESPN. We're going to make it our mission to get out and share with people about some of the other blue-collar athletes that went on to do great things. They may not be Hall of Famers, but they were great people and great team players. So we're going to be working on that, and we know it's going to have a lot of great success, and we're already getting a lot of traction on it. So this is one of my jerseys, but the team that originally drafted me, the Los Angeles Raiders. I played with the Los Angeles Raiders from 1991 to 95, and then I went to Oakland and played for the Oakland Raiders in 1996. So I have the distinction of playing with the Los Angeles Raiders as well as the Oakland Raiders, and I now work with the Las Vegas Raiders in Las Vegas, where my company is at today, Pro Player Promotion. My cameraman is based out of Las Vegas, Nevada. But anyway, I want to celebrate 30 years of the community, and I'm on Instagram. You can follow me, Poncho Glover, P-O-N-C-H-O Glover, to see some of the accolades, some of the pictures, some of the different things that I went in the vault and that I'm pulling out to bring people's attention to the accomplishments that I had back then, because a lot of people don't know about it. So I'm bringing, we didn't have the social media platforms that we have today, so now I have to, you know, go back and let them see exactly what happened and the truth of it. We have newspaper articles, we have video, we have community service, we have testimonials, and we have pictures to prove what I've done, okay? So we got that, and that's how we're going to do that. Poncho Glover, you can follow me on Instagram, and I just wanted to read a little bit of this community service right here that I got out of the newspaper to let you know exactly what I was doing on this particular day back in 95 when I was nominated by the Raiders for Man of the Year before we even called Walter Payton Man of the Year. Got with me. I was in Brown Hall at Grambling. In Brown Hall, you know, when you don't do good on your ACTs and all of that, they send you to the developmental building to make it get you right until you get ready to go into the general population of the university. Because we don't want no dummies over here with us who ain't passed their classes. So I was only in there for one semester, but I got a couple of my teammates I know. They used to walk. It was separate from the campus, so they know I know. Okay. I tested out in one semester. All right. They tried to target me, but I wasn't having it. At any rate, I'm going to read one of my posts that I have on that Instagram. And it reads, "The National Football League's Man of the Year has been a prestigious award given to an active player who excels not only on the field, but in the community as well. In 1995, this proud program will even stronger with the support of True Value as its major sponsor. One of this year's Raider nominees is tight end Andrew Glover. Andrew Glover's effort in the community extended nationally. Since his first season with the Raiders, he has been working hand in hand with both the Inglewood and Manhattan Beach Police Department, their programs, local Special Olympics, and Watts Summer Games. Andrew was an active member of the Midnight Madness Basketball League, which played a vital role in the local gang truce by offering friendly competition. Throughout the season, Andrew sponsors children in his church, Power of Love Christian Ministry, by offering tickets to games for good grades. 1995 marked the first year an alumni has individually organized a fundraiser for Grambling State University when Andrew produced a celebrity basketball game that raised $12,000 for the university's foundation. Andrew also founded the Glover House in Houston, Texas. This project extends a helping hand to homeless by offering food, clothes, and a place to get a new start. Glover did not miss a start in 94, and he was a valuable weapon on the Raider arsenal. His pure athleticism enables him to hold his own in the trenches while possessing the grace needed to catch a touchdown pass." Ever since the day that I was drafted into the National Football League, I was taught by the great Willie Brown, who's a Hall of Famer here at Grambling and who was well respected throughout the Raider organization. When I went there, I was comforted by his presence and him being a Grambling man and taking me into the fold and teaching me not only how to get to that level, but to maintain that level and take care of my business in the community as well and give back to the community. So this is one of the articles from 94 95, but I'm celebrating over 30 years of being in the community, and we're going to continue to work in the community, we're going to continue to impact people's lives, and we're going to continue to influence change at our university and help the underserved community. Thank you. On the schedule, but Eddie Robinson's grandson is here and present, and we have been working and talking with him about bringing back the Eddie Robinson Senior Memorial Football Camp run by GMen and the GMen Nation. So we're trying to form a collaboration and make sure that he's gone, but he'll never be forgotten because his disciples dwell in this earth, and it is our job to teach and to preach and to tell people about his greatness and the greatness of believing in God and going out and working in a competitive atmosphere.
Oh, yeah.
Deal done.
Greetings from the Eddie Robinson family. I'd like to say, by God's grace, and with that said, by God's grace is why I'm here tonight. I wasn't scheduled to be here, but with several motivators, one in particular, I'm looking at to my right, Sean Smith, Arvie, you call him Big Brother, right? So does that, we went to Grambling together in 1983, so does that make me your big, smaller brother? All right. But by God's grace, I'm here. Sorry for my tardiness, had to work a full day, and you know, other than Sean being a motivator for me being here, I want to thank Ms. Keye Foster. She was a big reason why I'm here. The Smiths, Lonnie and Melva Smith, and Cassandra Smith, I want to thank you guys for putting me up and taking care of me. But it's indeed an honor to be here tonight, tardy and all, to just come and fellowship and, you know, just see what the G-Men Nation are about. And Arvie, Big Sean, others, Jiles, I mean, we talk it up all the time about, you know, pushing things forward, moving the envelope. The big thing is the emphasis on our youth. And you guys knew my grandfather as well as any. He was big on developing young men into men. And so with that said, Arvie, G-Men Nation, whatever I can do to help, I mean, we're all one big family here. And seeing folks, some I hadn't seen in a while, some I probably have seen last week, but we're like family here. Keifer, I mean, this time last week, I was actually in Baton Rouge for an award. Coach Wilbert Ellis was being honored. And I was late getting there because I had to put in a work day. And traffic started backing up on Interstate 10. This was probably about 7 o'clock. So I said, hey, I'm going to get off. And you know, I ended up getting off on Eddie Robinson Senior Drive and made my way to LSU, which is where the event was happening. So I just left the hood last week. But hey, it's an honor. I'm not going to be long. Big Sean, man, keep doing what you're doing, okay? You encourage us all, my brother. And hey, I'm not going to be long. I want to be short-winded, and thank you guys for having me. Again, greetings from the Eddie Robinson family. Thank you. Also, when you follow Poncho Glover, I mean, let me go next time for Andrew Glover, because he's a tough act to follow, but a lot of folks don't know Poncho is like family. He and my dad, Eddie Robinson Jr., were real, real close. And, you know, Poncho, in his honor and Grandpa's honor, we got to get the football camp back rolling. Okay?
Sir.
All right. Thank you, guys.
Very special and very dear to me, but also very special and very dear to our organization, G-Men Nation, Inc. And I'm going to read this. G-Men Nation, Inc., with our greatest appreciation, we hereby present Gloria Pierce, This award, in recognition of your generous contribution to Dinner with the Pros, thank you from GMen Nation, June 10, 2022. This woman has been such a supporter of me. I come to her and I talk to her all the time about the Win League, GMen Nation Inc., this, that, and the other. And she said, baby, what you need sister to do? And I said, I need yada, yada, yada. She said, no doubt. I got you. So I just want to say thank you for being our CFO sponsor of our event. I love you. You mean the world to me and our family. And I'm not going to say much more because the young lady that was here from MAC did a wonderful job, and I don't want to cry these eyelashes out. It's Gloria Pierce.
That was a good fake one on me. I got it.
And finally, I would be remiss if I did not show much thank and gratitude to the individual, the husband and a wife team that allowed us to make this possible. I want to express my sincere thanks to Mr. and Mrs. Glenn Cox. Thank you for allowing us to host this event here and being our membership sponsor. We appreciate you, and you're now, you're part of our family. You're part of the GMen Nation.
Thank you. I really appreciate y'all even wanting to come up here, let alone let us come with you. Is that okay?
That's all right. We have a good time.
Thank you. But anyway, as Mr. Glenn is a member, I'm just sort of the tag along.
Now. And there's my best friend.
Right there.
Come on, say something. Come on, man. Come on, say something. What you got to say?
Come on up here.
I can't have a picture without this guy.
Bring it from the gut. Bring it from the gut, baby. Hell, man.
Glenn was my first boss. Sally was our first real estate agent. It's a package deal. This is my buddy here. Yeah.
Getting closer to time to bring the event to a close, but we truly do appreciate once again everybody's support, everyone coming out and joining us for this wonderful event that we will be putting on an annual basis. I want to touch a little bit on we spoke on resources. But sometimes people don't really understand what that means. So one of our goals, one of our missions that we're working on, and we're pretty much close to launching and making a formal announcement, is we have a goal, a fundraising goal of $1 million a year. $1 million a year. Now that might sound like a lofty goal, but it really is not. If some of you have been paying close attention to the NIL or the name, image, and likeness that got some attention a few weeks ago with Coach Nick Saban and Coach Prime and Coach Jimbo Fisher, and they were talking about in the tune in a neighborhood of $20 million to support their players with NIL deals and payments. Ohio State coach recently came out and said $13 million. So I think as supporters of Grambling in particular, $1 million is not a lofty goal. We have a lot of supporters, not just alumni, but a lot of supporters. And I think we were basing the number off of, I have to double check my figures, but 2,500, I think the number was 2,500 people. And you contribute $33.33 a month. That brings you to a little under $1 million a year. We can do this. We just have to do it. All right? I have a tattoo right here. I wish I could show you. But, and I can't take credit. I think I got it from a song. I think it was something. But it's, don't talk about it. Be about it. Don't talk about it. Be about it. It's time to stop talking, and we got to do the work. So let's do this, and let's hit that goal. Actually, we surpass the goal, but that's just the floor. We're trying to break the glass here. So thank you all again for coming out. Really appreciate it.
I want to second that. I definitely want to second that about the fundraising. We definitely thank each and every person that came out tonight. And I think the important thing is that we're just asking you to play your role and your responsibility and do your part like we're doing. We're not asking anybody to not do what they're not capable of doing, but tell your friends, tell somebody about the experience we had. Tell a sponsor, tell them about the G-Man Nation. Tell them to go to the website. Tell them to learn and get an opportunity to learn a little bit more about Eddie Robinson and the legacy he left with us through his players. Tell other people, engage other people. If you see an opportunity where we can collaborate, with a firm, with a sponsor, then we relish that opportunity to get together and find out what makes us more similar than focusing on the things that make us different, because we are trying to help people. Somebody helped me. I didn't do it by myself. I went over that, although I would like to get the credit for it. And I did put in the work, and I put in the time, and I put in the effort, and I practiced, and I gave up my summers going home every year and stayed at the university so I can be on path to graduate in 4 years and to have the opportunity to play 3 sports and graduate in 4 years. Nobody does that except me. And that's because I had to have it. That's what makes me different than any other athlete that you know. And I know that that's what makes me different. And I'm happy about that. I'm the luckiest man in the world, like Coach Rob would say. I got a family that loves me. I got a wife. I got kids. I got a home. I'm eating good. It looks like my jersey's fitting tighter every day. But guess what? I don't have to come out and ask anybody for anything because I'm good. You don't have to have that attitude that I'm good. We good. Lend a helping hand to somebody in need, and that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to make sure that our legacy is never forgotten, and the people that blood, the sweat, the tears, all my teammates, the love, the respect, and the adulation that we have for each other. We are the most exclusive football fraternity in the history of HBCU. That is grand. Just share our vision. what we talked about, how we had a good time, and how the everybody felt good, we ate good, we broke bread. It's limitless. Nothing is impossible. All you need to do is bring it up. God gonna do the rest. We're not worried. We've achieved great things in just 1 year. And that's because we've had people, all our sponsors put in the effort. All our volunteers put in the effort. Nobody on our team tried to be the GOAT, the greatest of all time. This is a collaborative effort. Every man does their job, or woman. Thank you very much. We certainly appreciate you. And please check out the website, gmennation.org.
One last word. I want to thank everybody who was a part of the planning commission's committee. all the organizers for this event. So I want to thank everybody. I see Mr. and Mrs. Consonary over here to my right. Just thank you once again. Really appreciate it.
At this time, once again, we thank you for coming. And I know how Black Baptist people are. They get kind of tired after preaching and preached a long time. They be ready to go home. So we're going to dismiss you. We're going to ask that my brother in Christ and my G-Man brother, Reverend Adrian Constantine, come and close us out in prayer. God bless each and every one of you all.
Let us go to God. Father God in heaven, thank you. Thank you for allowing us to see another day. Father, there are many out there that won't get another chance to see another day. Father, but as we had this opportunity to see another day, Father, I pray that you looked at us and said, you did good today. Father, I pray that we can get another day, Father, to be able to represent you. Not represent you in the part or, you know, kind of here or kind of there, but in full, Father. Father, help us to be brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, that's the only way that this world is going to change. Father, I pray that you please continue to bless the G-Men Nation. What have you done in just 1 year? Father, you've allowed us to achieve something that we knew we can do in you, but we knew we couldn't do without you. Father, I pray that each and every one of us realize that we can accomplish so much more with just having a relationship with you. Father, help us to understand what it is about to have a relationship with you, a true relationship with you. Father God, I pray that you please bless every heart that's in here. I pray that everyone makes it home safe. Father, just continue to just watch over us, Father, as you give us more days, Father. I just pray that we can make the most of it. Father God, we love you. We thank you for this evening. It is in your precious Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Class dismissed.
Run with my sons to battle go, for hills will ring from shore to shore. Oh, Grambling, dear Grambling, we
working with you. Flowers.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. You're all too kind.
Hey, boy.
Can I get an encore? Do you want more? Cook you with the Brooklyn Guns. So for one last time, I need y'all to go. Now what the hell are you waiting for? After me, there should be no more. So for one last time, make some noise. Who you know, freshman? Riddle me out. The rest of y'all know where I'm living with y'all. Can't none of y'all hear me back. Can't hear me rap. It's like Angie rapping his prime. I'm your ancient best bit. Damn, take over the globe. I'm a country, but the blueberry still connect. On the low, but the guy got a triple deck. But when you yell with the blue respect, grand opening, grand closing. Damn your manhole, crack the can, open the can. Who you gonna find open the hand with no hand? Just draw a bitch, great shoes. Who you gonna see, you can't replace him. Cheap imitation, this generation. I got an encore, do you want more? Cook him,
one more.
Brooklyn balls, one last time, I need y'all to roll.
Thank you, guys.
Just a matter of years. It's fate for having J status or pairs to be at an all-time high. Perfect time to say goodbye. When I come back like Jordan, wearing it 4-5. It ain't to play games with you. It's to aim at you. Probably maim you. If I owe you, I'm blowing you to smithereens. Suck a take one for your team. And I need you to remember one thing. I came, I said I'll come.
Slide away,
so
slide in there. Get in the picture.
I need you to scream to your lungs this song.
Man, you in here, man. Represent with it.
This man.
Call him over there, too.
Killing all y'all cats. Y'all want more than two.
One more. Three. Two. Hook it up. The hook's up. Okay, all right. Yeah, we got hooks. We got new for everybody up in here. Appreciate y'all. Squeeze in a little bit more. Right there. Are we good? All right, hold it right there. 3, 2, 1 more. Hold it. 3, 2. All right, you want to grab some more people? Get them in there.
So this here's the victory lap and I'm leaving. That's how you get me back after a year of 16.
Y'all requested for some pictures over there. Joe, you lined up and you talking. What you gonna do?
We'll
get it. 3, 2, 1
more.
3, 2. All right, that's nice. All right, switch it up a little bit. Everybody move around to make somebody different. Don't run away, bro. All right. 3, 2, 1 more. 3, 2. All right. You jumping in? Jumping up. I can't see you behind the hat. I can't see you. There you go. 3, 2, 1 more. 3, 2. Oh, yeah. Nice.
Calling all night. I can pull the room when I'm being polite. Darling, calling all night. I can be a fool when I'm being polite. Oh, me. Oh, me. Oh, my. I know many women want to be in my life.
You gotta get my guy.
Y'all got it. I burn through the hood like a, when everybody feeling so cold, I cool like that King Cole.
living like gold. And then they wanna get in my glue. Yo, I got bad love for my cool mom. I'm the man who you want. Shine bright like a jewel, mama. Even on the side,
oh, yeah, that's nice, right there.
Last one, three,
even when she go away. Even when she go away.
Appreciate y'all.
Where you gonna post these pictures?
Where your phone at? You can put your phone next to this card, and my contact information will jump in there.